I'm sure as you guys see, you know, you look at the younger generations, these 20-year-olds, you walk around, everybody's soft.
Oh my God, this is tender.
Yeah, that Piedmontese stuff is
this is ridiculous.
Have you had Piedmontese stuff?
I have, yeah. You can cut this with a spoon.
Yeah, this, I'm really impressed with their...
I can't believe how lean... Even the ribeyes are,
yeah.
and tender.
Yep.
Even their top sirloins, which are usually pretty tough.
The studies don't say this, and the studies don't say that, and I just think the studies don't tell us enough about anything. On paper that might work.
Who are they studying is what I always think, too.
Yeah, none of them are jacked, so it's like a different...
I don't train.
Like on paper, they'll say, oh, you should have more...
I don't sleep properly.
You should have more polyunsaturated fat in your diet. You know, you should trade out your beef fat with, like, canola oil, like he's saying. But there's no proof that that would be any good. There's no proof that that's superior for health. It's all just stuff on paper that they're extrapolating.
Well, those studies, the intervention is never replacing a whole food with canola oil. It's always replacing, butter with
there
canola
oil. There was a 2020, it's a JAMA, or American Medical Association, American Heart Association study, I think it was JAMA. And they said state of the art study on cardiovascular disease. And they basically said saturated fat from whole foods, steak, dairy, eggs, chocolate, have no negative impact on cardiovascular disease.
Yeah, that's my point. What do you replace that with? Is it butter? Is it palm oil in a an overfeeding study? What are you replacing it with?
They say it has no, like the cholesterol in the food, right? It has no impact on your cholesterol levels. But then we hear a lot of people, like Derek from More Plates, More Dates, who seems reasonably intelligent, says that if you eat eggs before you go in for your cholesterol test, your cholesterol will shoot through the roof. Is that just temporary?
Temporary, because there's a delay between the time that your liver compensates for the increase or decrease.
Look at Klusman.
So it doesn't mean much because it's temporary.
If you're doing a non-fasting study, it's worthless. I mean,
right.
So look at Dave Feldman with the bread. He ate like a ton of bread, and then like his cholesterol was nuts.
Really?
He didn't even eat cholesterol. He didn't. I mean, there was some, but it was like negligible. But he did a bunch of different ways of getting. I mean, he's got his blood tested something like 300 something times, and showed all these ways to like crank up your cholesterol.
Yeah, Dave's.
None of which are related to anything with like negative
impact. They're going to publish a study. I think it's coming out in February or March this year.
He's super excited about it.
It's
a lean mass hyperresponders, but with the data on carotid artery studies and seeing if in fact these guys are showed higher risks of rates of cardiovascular disease. I suspect it's going to not.
The way the vegetable oil, like the people defending the vegetable oil have it, is kind of like the vegans, like the science is settled. Like this is definite. You know, like that's the way that they make it sound, and it just sounds like it's so much more open for interpretation than they want to let it be, you know?
Well, it's like we were talking about earlier. Yes, there's a risk factor. It's not significant, and it doesn't mean it's you should ignore it. But it pales in comparison if you were to set up a hierarchy in terms of what's
right.
What's the largest contributor? What's the highest hazard ratio for heart disease? Like if you go to the doctor and you're 40 pounds overweight and have type 2 diabetes, and then you also have elevated LDL, and he gives you a statin, that's a problem because the higher risk factor is the type 2 diabetes and the obesity and then in the elevated heart blood pressure. What are you doing about that? You know, if you want to make
it's hard to do stuff about that.
It really is. Yeah, it takes more than 7 minutes.
Right, right.
The average doctor visit. Hmm. And that's not to be arrogant because I know that, you know, from long-term research suggests that most dieters are probably only going to lose about 4 to 6% of their body weight.
Stan, what does testosterone do? Like, does it have negative? It can have a negative impact
HDL,
on your.
But we're having a hard time.
Cholesterol,
seeing.
But does it? Does the cholesterol? What it's doing? Does it have negative function on the heart? You think?
It can. It can increase LDL and lower HDL. Mm. But now you're talking. What's the dose? Mm. And
what's your lifestyle?
What was your predisposition? Did you have low? Were you hypogonadal to begin with?
Right.
Which can,
or are you just trying to get jacked?
Give you a higher, potentially increased risk of all-cause mortality. So what's the purpose of it as compared to what? You know, if your testosterone is 400, you try and get up to 800, probably not going to see a real benefit, real outcomes. I guess it would depend if you had associated symptoms, depression, ED. You know, it would have to be more than just the number on the test. It doesn't tell you too much. You know, you have to kind of ask a few more questions.
Right. Dr. Baker, why did you never have you ever used performance enhancing drugs at all? Well, why did you decide to go that route?
Oh, we're gonna need
look at him. He's already fucking jacked and strong.
That's a good answer.
Mm-hmm. I just never, you know, it's kind of weird. When I was first lifting weights, I was like 14, 13 years old. I was training at this little gym in Indiana. A lot of Chicago Bears used to train. And there was a guy who was a bodybuilder and he got sick. And I asked what happened. They had some liver issues. And I asked what happened. They said, well, he's taking drugs. And it just kind of scared me as a kid.
Right. Sure.
And then I never really, you know, I just never got into it. And, you know, really, to be honest, when I was probably competing in powerlifting, there was a form called Go Heavy. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Go Heavy,
yeah,
that Tony Cardella ran.
Yep.
And I was, you know, I was competing at USA Powerlifting. And I was like, you know, these guys are coming in and cheating. I was pissed. I was like, assholes shouldn't be doing that. But then I, you know, later
we were that way too because we were in a drug testing federation.
But then I was glad that they had like what was it WPO and the other ones that came and they said, "Oh, fuck it, rules are rules." And I said, "I'm just gonna stay in USAPL and live there," and I was happy with that. Later, I was like, "I don't care what people do. I'm just like for me, I you know, because I don't know that I have any desire to be significantly stronger than I am. It doesn't really at this point in my life. It doesn't do anything for me." I mean,
you were a rugby player who was getting stronger as opposed to. I mean, powerlifting wasn't really your end game.
Well, I mean, it's a base. I mean, I think for every, and this is a problem, I think everybody should be getting strong. You know, strength is never really, I think that's a baseline for just about every, most sports. There's a few sports where it may not be an advantage, but you lay that down, not only for sports, but just for life in general.
Yeah.
You lay that kind of, you know, you've gotten, you know, 200 pounds of lean mass on you. Now, that's going to stead you. Is your 50, 60, 70, or an 80. If you don't have that, I mean, it's gonna be a big problem.
Yeah.
You may have skipped a 305 though, right?
Yeah, I mean, when I was at my peak, I mean, but I was eating, you know, 8,000 to 9,000 calories a day. I mean, it was nothing for me to go to a restaurant and order 3 entrees. And then I have a dessert, and then I, you know, well, you know, the pig, we've all done that.
Yeah.
The pig out days.
Yeah, when you're getting big.
Remember when Ben and Jerry's had those little fun-sized pints, right? You know, it's like, a pint of ice cream. What is that?
It's nothing.
It's like, fun size.
give me 5 of those or something like that.
I used to do a Haagen-Dazs every night with dinner because it was just what was it? It's milk, cream, sugar, and strawberries.
No.
That's all that's in it. And that was like when I was here training with you, I would go to what's the name of that? I'd get a steak and potato, and then for dessert I'd get a small pan pizza, 3 days, 3 nights a week.
We were at Jack's Urban Eats, and you're like. We just got done, and you're like, "All right, I'm heading over to Cheesecake Factory." And I was like, "What?" Like, you got up, and I think you were going to like get a massage or something. And then after that, you're going to Cheesecake Factory.
Are we still rolling? Is the video still on?
I remember the massages.
Yeah. A massage.
Mm-hmm. When I was in the Air Force, you know, back when I was in my mid-20s. I used to launch nuclear bombs. You know, so that was my job to be the down. So we go down 100 feet underground. And we were locked in there for 24 hours. We had this 16-ton blast door. Our food would be cooked, and they would deliver it down for us. And you could eat whatever you wanted. And I would. And this is when I was trying to gain weight. When I first started like getting into powerlifting, when I went from 240 to like 280, I was eating everything. But I was into egg whites at that time. And I would say, no kidding, I'd say, make me an egg white, but egg white omelet, but I want 50 egg whites.
Yeah.
And a cook upstairs, they you know, they had to do it because I ordered and I paid for it, but they were just pissed. And the base was calling me and said, "Hey, dude, you're eating all our fucking eggs." Hey, I'm paying for it. Sorry, man.
Yeah.
But 50 egg whites, because you know egg whites aren't that much.
Right.
Like when you do it, but
right.
The cooks were like not happy with me.
Yeah. It's like I need 250 grams of protein.
And they have those ice. Remember those ice cream sandwiches? You know, I'd eat like 10 of those.
Oh yeah.
You know, it was just like.
Do I remember? I'm dirty bolts any time.
Ice cream sandwiches.
I told you the story one time about how when I was in my early 20s, I was dirty bulking.
Mm-hmm.
I used to get a blender, it was a 5-cup blender, and I would fill it with whole milk, ice cream, banana, protein powder, and you'd blend that thing up,
amazing.
And it was 5 cups. It was a lot of ice cream, so it was really cold.
Uh-huh.
And then you just chug the whole thing, and then a minute later, you'd be like, and it would just come out. And
it tasted good, right?
But it tasted good.
There we go.
Ice cream out the nose does not taste bad.
But seriously. But then
this realization hits you as soon as you throw it up. I did not get those calories. Mm-hmm. You have to make another one and drink it a little slower, mind you, so you get the brain freeze. Or you know, you didn't get the calories. I can't tell you how many times that, because it was so good and I drank it so fast, and then you get that cold, and then boom, it would happen. We gotta talk about this. This is not an advertisement for Piedmontese, but that was amazing.
But this is
what kind of steak was it?
There was a mix. There was
there was a ribeye, a filet, and it was New York.
Yep.
It was unbelievable. It just melts in your mouth.
One of those was a ribeye?
You could have cut it with a spoon.
Yeah, one of them was center.
How'd you cook it? Just in a little
air fryer. Yeah.
In an air fryer.
Yeah.
And it was as tender as could be. I told you guys a story.
That's why I'm trying my
when
best.
When I trained with Flex Wheeler, we would eat 4 pounds of top sirloin steak a day.
Yeah, he started you with, like, you had to add ounces to each meal, right?
Yeah, until eventually the last couple of months, we were eating 4 pounds a day. It would be like 7 meals. He had to spread them out pretty far. But we would cook them in a Foreman grill.
Yeah.
That was the toughest chunk. I mean, you were like cutting it.
Yeah, top sirloin.
You damn near needed like a chainsaw to get through it. And I was, eventually my teeth actually started to get loose. I could start to move them a little bit. So I, for a couple of 3 days there, I ate some fish and chicken.
Jeez.
And I would go to the gym, and Flex would weigh me every single day, twice a day. And then we would work out, and then he would have me pose afterwards. I lost like 3 or 4 pounds in 3 days.
And he's like, what's going on?
Yeah. And then Flex is like, what's going on? What are you doing? And Flex is the kind of guy who would look you in the eyes. He's very perceptive that way. You know, he's from a tough city, and so he's always watching people. And he knew I was fucking lying. I couldn't look him in the eyes. And Keith is right behind me, totally wrapped. Keith didn't say anything. Keith didn't want to wrap me out, but Keith knew I was not eating steak for 3 days. I was eating tilapia and fucking boneless, skinless chicken breast. And I lost like 3 pounds, and Flex was like, you're flat. He goes, your rep count is down. You know, he was counting every single rep, my rest times, everything. And so I told him, he said, well, my teeth are loose. He's like, suck it up. He goes, grind your meat. And that's when I first learned that you could buy top sirloin steak and you could bring it home and you could run it through a grinder. Because I didn't do as well with ground beef for some reason. And to this day, I still cannot explain it. And my co-author, Damon McCune,
couldn't keep your skin as tight and stuff.
Yeah, he was a consultant for the California Beef Council. He knows about as much about meat, both conventional and grass finished, as anybody. And I've had this conversation with him many times, and he's like, he goes, other than maybe some connective tissue or whatever, but I just never felt the same on ground beef as I did on steak in terms of leanness pre-contest. Off season didn't seem to matter. You know, I'd make the monster mash and get the calories in. But that was an intervention. But man, if I had some of this, like, you could have eaten that all by yourself, no problem, and have many times.
Oh, yeah.
The whole plate.
Well, we just had?
Yeah, we all shared it. You'd have finished that whole thing.
Yeah.
Just in an air fryer, and it was like you could have just pulled it apart. It was
I had one of these for breakfast. I had a Piedmontese before I came.
Yeah, yeah.
I got to ask though, Stan, like, what would the actual difference be if you, like, in that situation, steak versus ground beef, but if the macros were the same, the fat, the protein.
So there's a study that was done on ground beef versus steak. Actually, there's been a couple studies. So in humans, it was done in older men, and they showed better viability for the protein for actually ground beef, because older people, and again, this is not you and I, but this is
kind of,
because we're not old, right? We're talking old. They can't chew as well, and you get better surface area, and you get better absorption. That's why protein powder has such a rapid absorption compared to whole foods. And so that's one thing. Also, the rendering of the fat seems to have a differential effect in some people, and sometimes you'll lose some of that out, you know, and a lot of people won't tolerate it as well. There was a study on pigs. It was interesting, looking at bioavailability for protein. It was called like pigs and ribeyes. And so they fed pigs ribeyes, actually, which is kind of interesting. And they also fed them ground beef and bologna and a few other things.
Expensive looked at that pig.
That was a happy pig, I'm sure. Yeah. And they were looking at the bioavailability, and they were looking at the doneness of the temperatures. And they looked at raw ground beef versus cooked ground beef, and ribeye is at medium versus well done versus rare, and it was all done. But it was interesting. The best was like a medium steak, and you know, it was like bologna had some of the best protein bio. It was kind of an interesting study.
Bologna,
interesting. Yeah.
You guys got to tell me which cuts those are and what temperature and for how long you cook those. I'm going to go straight home and cook those Piedmontese.
We can get a bunch sent to you.
Those are delicious.
Yeah. That's what I was trying to get you guys. I know it's not easy to get set up logistically, but if you guys can offer that.
Yeah.
I think a good thing idea
they're
for
ground
you,
beef,
Stan,
they're 96% ground beef, really good too.
A good idea for you would just be to go out there sometime. Just see the whole operation, talk to those guys, and then you know,
yeah,
see
Shane,
if it works.
Shane, I've been out there. Shane,
where they located?
Yeah, they're in Nebraska, by Lincoln, Nebraska. So.
But what's cool is, like, they'll totally take care of you. They'll cook you, like, a big-ass dinner. Like, they've had, like, O'Hearn out there. They've had, like, they like having people out there.
I was there 2 years ago. So my birthday, they cooked me a big steak for my birthday.
Yeah, it's
like,
awesome.
It was, like, 2 years ago today. I was, well, yeah. My birthday's on Monday, but, yeah, so.
I'll have to tell you the story one time about how when Mark Ripito roasted a lamb for me. Good God. I was supposed to, I went to Texas to do a seminar, and he's about 2 hours away. So he said, hey, why don't you come up with a podcast? So I ate a meal right after the seminar, and I drove up. It was 2 hours. I figured that was just about perfect. By the time we got to dinner and ate, it'd be 3 hours between meals. And I eat about that often, pretty regularly. But I got up there. We shot the shit for an hour. Then his house is an hour away from the gym. Then he pulls this roast out of the freezer and says, I'm going to cook this on this grill, which was a wood grill that he had to light and let heat up for 45 minutes first. And it took another hour or more to cook the lamb. So there was like 7 hours between the time I left the
lamb,
my last meal, and we were up at finally eating the lamb. It was delicious. But 7 hours, I'm like, I'm dizzy by then.
Yeah.
It was, but it was
That's
it was
like
awesome.
Your friend James, when he cooked up lamb, it took forever.
Oh, yeah.
James
oh, yeah.
Smith. Because you cook it pretty slow.
Yeah. He's like,
you've heard the expression, hunger is the best sauce. As a friend said that. Yeah. When you're hungry, everything tastes good. Yeah. It's just right.
Well, you know, Chris and I talked about this earlier, like the difference between vertical diet and the carnivore diet, just being kind of carbohydrates, really. You know, some fruit and potassium foundation. But I found when I was traveling a lot and not training as much, that the lower in carbs I went, the longer I could go between meals, and the less hangry I got.
So there's it's a, so weird. There's an interesting study, I think, that was done, and I can't reference it right now, but they looked at hormones like CCK, cholecystokinin, which does have a satiety-provoking effect. And when you add carbohydrates to a meal, you have less stimulation of CCK, and therefore you have less satiety. And that's why, for your guys, they're wanting to eat more and gain more weight, and you've mentioned this.
It's, purposely increase
right. It makes her appetite better,
yeah.
And that's what you see. Like I can easily go. Like I don't eat frequently. I eat twice a day.
Yeah.
You know. Like I mean, today I'll do an exception because I had breakfast. I wasn't sure what we were doing, so I just ate in case.
Right.
So I had bacon and I had steak and eggs for breakfast.
Yeah.
But I mean, I can go 24 hours between meals. I can go 16.
But if you were pounding white rice, there's no way you'd be.
I'd still be
hungry.
Yeah,
and tired.
You know, and you know, like I said, you know, in the 5 years I've been doing the carnivore diet, there's been, you know, a few days here and there, like, you know, every once in a while I'll have some other crap, I'll have some fruit or something like that. My appetite picks up. I'm like, I'm so hungry, and then I'll eat some more. And you know, like I said, if I wanted to get 280 pounds again, I would include carbs. I mean, it's, you know,
yeah,
I mean, that's
one more meal a day.
Well, I mean, I can do it with meat, but I'm miserable. I mean, I, you know, I mean, I'm like
hard to eat that much meat.
It is. It's like, you know, who's a guy? Was it Serge Nubret that was doing in the 70s?
Yeah.
And he was eating 7 pounds of horse meat a day.
Yeah. Well, that's what I've said about the vertical diet. It's not, I didn't invent this. Vince Garanda was promoting steak and eggs in the 60s.
Right, sure. But the refeed there.
But somehow, somehow, our industry got away from that with the whole guru diet, in which I first saw in the late 80s when I was training, particularly women for competition, would have the worst side effects from that kind of over-restriction, the egg whites, tilapia, and broccoli. And so I, at that time, started intervening and saying, no, you need to keep red meat in, you need to keep a little bit of fruit in, you should keep some calcium in, particularly if you're a woman. And we were getting better results, both in terms of their energy levels, their ability to maintain lean body mass on a diet, and then the rebound, because I was keeping electrolytes in, I wasn't pulling salt out. And so they weren't having the same problems with edema and depression and massive weight regain the week following. And that was fine when it was isolated to the industry. We've kind of talked about this before. Now, some 25 years later, with the explosion of this, what I call the professional dieting industry, bodybuilding, figure, physique, bikini, wellness, Jesus, it just keeps going, mankini, with the explosion of this industry, now we've got the general public, the soccer moms, seeing all these women in the best shape of their lives and not understanding that behind the scenes, they're suffering. And if it weren't for their consumption of thyroid and Anaphor and clenbuterol, they would never survive this prep. And the soccer moms aren't utilizing and shouldn't utilize those interventions. And so they're having all of the problems and the rebound that occurs from the chronic over-restriction and the female triad. and they end up with
amenorrhea,
osteoporosis, yeah, and the chronic calorie deficit, anemia, and that's what I see a lot of now. And they usually come to me because they heard me talk somewhere on a podcast about that kind of thing after they've had this experience, not prior. It's frustrating.
Well, we're going to see the further demonization of that. You know, this is the problem. You know?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, the prices have already skyrocketed.
Really?
Yeah. That's
the red meat prices.
Meat prices across the board are about 20% up on red meat. Yeah. All animal products are up. Dairy's up 15%. Eggs are up 10%. So it's going up. And, you know, like, you know, we may be able to absorb that. There are a lot of people are just like, it's the difference between getting nutrition and you know, buying cheap box food. That,
yeah, the more distance we have from that, the more unhealthy the population will probably become.
Okay. If they're chasing cost per calorie, they're probably not getting enough protein,
of course.
And then it's mostly packaged food. God, this is good.
Do we know exactly why prices have come up? Is it an agenda reason or an economic reason?
Well, I mean, you know, if you listen to what they say it's part of it is labor shortages, okay. Fuel prices. Shipping, there's some processing bottlenecks, you know, a lot of the there's in the United States, four companies run about 85% of our beef. They're Cargill, Tyson, National Beef, which is bought by a Brazilian company, came Marfrig, and then JBS, which is the largest meat company in the world, also out of Brazil. And they basically are shortchanging the ranchers. They're giving them bottom dollar for their beef, and then they're overpriced charging on the retail side. So they've just got a monopoly. And this is one of the things that the current administration is trying to address. They're really kind of doing lip service. If you look at what they're planning on doing, they're gonna, you know, instead of, so what we need is a bunch more small processing plants so that the rancher can get his food to market at a fair price. What they're doing is they say we're gonna make a few more large processing plants, which is really not, I mean, it's kind of lip service. It's not really doing what it needs to do. So the best thing to do, I think, is for everybody like you guys, you know, direct from the ranchers like Piedmontese, or go, like, I bought a half a cow from some, you know, one of the ranchers up near me, and as much as I can afford it. I had to get freezer space first. That was the first thing to get, my chest freezer.
Yeah.
And every time I go to the, you know, if I go to the store and something's on sale, I just go buy it and throw it in my freezer so I just have it in case who knows what happens. But you know, it's an important priority because, you know, I'm sure as you guys see, you know, you look at the younger generations, these 20-year-olds, and you walk around, everybody's soft.
Yeah.
There's no hard men. I mean, there's no one coming up. You look at it's like,
interesting you bring that up because there was somebody on Instagram talking about endocrine disruptors and plastic, and I'm like, look, they're overweight. They're eating more processed food.
That's a tiny effect, you know, I think. You
know. The endocrine disruptors.
Right, I mean, I think it's not the big issue. It's not the elephant in the room.
If you're an Olympian,
that's something to pay attention to. When you're talking 1%, you know, like most of the stuff a lot of the stuff we talk about is that 1% stuff, but for the average person, man, it's just, God, get some food.
Trying to win
food,
Olympic gold
protein,
medal, maybe not worry about your shampoo.
You know, do some exercise and get some sleep.
You're so protein, not enough sleep, probably
not enough sunlight, probably.
But then the excess body fat, of course, now we know that that's not a dormant, that has its own hormonal measure and converts testosterone to estrogen. I would think if you were going to look at, again, a hierarchy of what more likely causes that testosterone decrease in the last, 50 years, because we have pretty good statistics on it from World War II.
Yeah, they're down significantly.
Yeah.
It's like 70% less testosterone overall. But
if I've got to choose between whether or not I eat water out of a plastic, or drink water out of a plastic bottle, and whether or not I get more sleep, lift weights, get sufficient protein, and keep my BMI, you know, those are obviously much greater influencers.
I also think years ago, you know, you wouldn't be just on the internet all the time.
And well,
it's like,
what would you do to fill that
time in? You would do something probably for yourself.
Well, I mean, you know, we've got the metaverse coming, right? So we have kids plugged into that. You know, and, you know, honestly, you get people who are so miserable in real life. I mean, they hurt. They're in horrible shape, and they're like, "Oh, I'll just plug into the metaverse and be a superhero." Yep. And they're gonna get sucked more and more into it. And they're not gonna be able to, you know.
Yeah, they just melt into the couch. They look like their recliner.
Well, you saw, you know, you got my kid about that. Yeah. I put that all in Wally, the little movie, you know, Wally, where all the people are
that's
in their hover chairs.
Yeah,
it is. It's coming. I mean, you go to the grocery store and you see these Wally people. You guys see on my Instagram? I put up the fattest man in 1890, the world's fattest man, and he was like 350. He was the world's fattest man. And people paid money to see him.
Wow. Yeah.
You know, back in the day. And now it's like, let's go to friggin' the grocery store. If I want to see
Walmart.
That.
They're all in the places. Like,
there's 100 of them.
They don't even get paid for it.
Exactly. That's a shame. Maybe they should be.
Well, you hit the word shame. And this discussion isn't about shaming. It's not about, you know, although that is a pretty common tactic in Japan. It's about health. And I know people are squawking about diet culture.
Right.
You know, it's our woke group that won't recognize that it is does increase all cause mortality.
Absolutely. Well, I saw there's people out there now that says being obese has nothing to do with health. And I literally saw a woman saying that if you lose body fat, it's actually harmful to you. Yeah. And I'm like, you've got to be crazy. But there are so many other things that show, you know, all-cause mortality, depression, dementia, diabetes, all associate very strongly with excess body fat. You know, and
the location of that fat matters. Obviously, you know, women can carry subcutaneous
fat.
Hip and subcutaneous fat.
Yeah,
it also depends on what people are marking for their health. Like, if you're just not capable of doing certain things, it's a compromise.
Y'all done?
It's a compromise. You can't get up and down the stairs. You can't get in out of your car. You can't do, you know, the stuff that you normally should be able to do, then that's a huge compromise. But people don't think of it that way.
No, go ahead, dive in.
They don't think of it as that big of a...
I've got four steaks in my bag.
You're on the grip.
I don't eat meat.
And I got to say this on that topic. This isn't about... Here we all sit around here, you know, from our pulpit with the level of conditioning that we've, you know, because we love to do
right,
this.
Right, we like, all have mental disorders.
Our expectation isn't that everyone... invests what we do into this and has similar outcomes. A six-pack is not required. A simple 7% loss of body fat, you're a 300-pound person that loses 20 pounds, can improve 95% of their fatty liver as tested with biopsy. That would be sufficient to give you a better longevity outcome, to probably reverse, in many cases, type 2 diabetes. A 15% loss could restore beta cell function. But that's sufficient. So I have a number of clients. I have a 380-pound guy who got down to 340, and his blood pressure is like 118 over 75 now. And you'd think a 340-pound man would be unhealthy, but his blood tests come back, and all of his diabetes markers are great, fasted insulin, fasted glucose, HbA1c, triglycerides. He lost 40 pounds, and that was sufficient enough as compared to where he was previously. And now he's regularly walking after meals and doing things to obviously increase his protein to help with postprandial glycemia. But that is sufficient. He does not need a six-pack. And he does complain to me that he's kind of plateaued recently. And I'm like, look, you're a healthy man. Your cardiovascular disease risk has gone down, you know, significantly.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned Japan
and the shame.
And the shame, because what they do, you know, essentially what they do at restaurants, they weigh people.
Yeah.
And they say you are allowed to have X amount of food, but it's kind of interesting because if you're a little person, you're allowed less food, is what it is. If you're just big, but at work, their companies, the government takes companies and says you are responsible for your employees' body weight and waist circumference, and if 20% of them or whatever exceed this, you're going to pay extra money or you're not going to get your reward as well. So the private companies are like, and you see the Japanese are all working, they're doing jumping jacks before they go to their start the shift.
So the kids, this is from a very young age, the kids are getting up and doing jumping jacks. Yeah. When I owned my telephone company, I purchased a gym, a large 30,000 square foot gym, and it had an upstairs track and it had some racquetball courts that I put the equipment in. I made it into a call center because I had over 100 employees that were answering calls every day, but I kept the equipment in and people would be walking around the track, and I set up incentive programs for that very same thing, for weight loss or, you know, health programs, and people would get an incentive. I was paying them to improve their health.
You probably had better productivity.
That was the big thing. I saw it in terms of attendance, you know, just general, I think, positive mood, all those things were influenced pretty well. And they would get together as groups and they would, you know.
Do the whole thing.
Yeah, that was a huge benefit.
What do you recommend if you have somebody that's like really heavy? You know, like I have my podcast partner, weighs 480.
Yeah.
And he's been trying to do carnivore. I think you know Russell. He was in here before, big dude. So he's like producing my podcast, right? And he's trying to lose weight and he's tried all these things. where do you put somebody that's that big on like a protein level? You don't want to give them 480 grams of protein.
No, no.
So you give them
a pound of lean body weight.
You give them like 200 pounds.
Sufficient. Yeah, whatever their lean weight is.
Whatever their projected lean weight is.
Yeah.
Russell seems like he's 240, 250 in terms of lean weight.
Yeah, and the protein wouldn't just be for retaining lean muscle mass. That's obviously the primary thing, but it would be for both the thermic effect of food and satiety. That would be the benefit. If you were going to consume, if he needed extra calories, let's say, if he was hungry and he wanted more calories, you'd feed him to them in protein, mm-hmm. not because it has, you know, a better benefit for lean mass retention, more than 1 gram per pound of lean weight, but because it would help them with satiety and thermic effect of food. So, we talked about Jose Antonio's overfeeding studies at the ISSN. Yeah, found it was really hard for people.
500 or 600 grams of protein a day, I think.
Yeah, somewhat.
I interviewed Jose, and he actually said there was a guy, it was interesting, he said he was eating, he was one of the guys who was eating like the 500-600 grams a day, and it said it really didn't matter how much he ate with regard to his weight after a certain, it was weird, he said if he was eating 300 grams or 600 grams, his weight didn't really change.
That seems like it just disappears.
It was interesting.
I've had that happen too. Eat a lot of protein doesn't.
Hardly anybody could adhere to the 2+ grams per pound. They were having to use protein shakes to get there, which protein powder doesn't provide the same satiety benefit, but still, those people were having a hard time eating enough protein and not gaining weight. Eating that much protein and not gaining weight. That's not to say that you can't overeat protein for calories, but it's hard to do.
It is.
I think you're right on the protein shakes as far as like, you say that shakes are for fakes kind of thing. It seems like when you're trying to lose weight, protein shake is like more of a reminder of like something yummy that you used to have when you were fat, right? Like, I feel like, but it doesn't provide any satiety. Like you're saying, it doesn't provide them with the satiety that they're looking for.
Yeah, less so than food.
I think people are like, oh, but I really look forward to the shake. And it's like, I'm trying to get people more into like...
Well, I mean, you'd rather have me the shake than a friggin' cheesecake. I mean,
yeah, absolutely.
It's like, absolutely. Yeah.
The video that I did where I talked about that, I said it's convenient and it tastes good. I said the same thing about my meal prep company. It's not magic. It's convenient and it tastes good. For those people who don't have an alternative, a shake can augment a deficient protein meal, or it can replace in the absence of a meal, like in terms of convenience for post-workout when you're at the gym and you might not be able to get another meal in for a couple hours, and this isn't a deep dive into the anabolic window. It's just, you're right, it's convenient and tastes good. And sometimes I drink things before or after workouts just because I enjoy it. And we see now that just the fullness, not necessarily even the macro composition, just having something for the sense of fullness gives you more, what would we say, a concentration during the workout. I don't know what the right adjective is to use here, but it just allows you to stay focused longer so you can train a little longer, maybe get an extra set in or an extra rep in, which the cumulative effect of that over time is what gives you the results.
Yeah, I don't know. I've never been a big bench press, but when I was trying to work on a bench, I found that if I had a big, full meal, I could bench better.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it was just kind of, maybe it's just the changing in my abdominal pressure or something, but that was something that I used to
We've
see.
We've always said, right before the gym, the one question you always ask Eric Spoto about bench, he's like, he'd always say the bench press goes up and down with body weight.
Yeah.
That was the first thing he'd say, and it seems to be true. We've all experienced it. Mm-hmm. You know, it might not be true of the deadlift, but it's certainly true of the bench. When your weight goes down, it's really hard.
I would eat a bunch of bagels before I go lift. Drink a bunch of water. Yeah, be all bloated. It was great.
Yeah, well, I mean, from satiety. I mean, have you seen studies on just you know, there's hormones that affect your satiety, at the ghrelin, CCK, things like that. But also, if it's mechanoreceptors, and this is why a lot of the fiber
is utilized. The stomach.
But I've done like when I've been. Times I've tried to get lean, last year, I think when I was 53, I got pretty lean. I might do that again this year. But what I found was, like late at night when ghrelin is peaking, because ghrelin is a diurnal hormone, it kind of peaks in the evening. That's why everybody's like 8 o'clock at night looking in the cabinets for something. Yeah. And so you have to deal with that. And I found like those Element things, I'll throw a blender of ice and an Element pack in there and blend it up. And it's like a sorbet. And I might eat three of those. I mean, but it's like 10 calories.
Yeah.
It's electrolytes, 10 calories. and it's like that much friggin' fluid. And then I'm like, and that fills me up enough to where I'm like, okay, I can deal it. I can go to bed, and then my ghrelin hormone is going to go back down, and I'm not hungry. And so that works pretty well. It's
that's true.
I feel like bone broth is good for that too. Just something hot, something warm.
I never like drinking hot drinks. The other thing I was doing is I'd make my own Jello. I take like an oxygen.
Oh, Jello's great.
And I just throw some of an element pack in there and make it into Jello. And then I got the biggest friggin' bowl. Like it's like a, you can bathe in it, right? And I'll just fill it up with Jello.
Just protein, pretty much, right?
It's pretty, it's protein,
So
it's
electrolytes, too. That's good.
Electrolytes, not many calories. And that's another, satiety hack I found. Anyway.
Let's podcast.
All right, let's do it.